thank you for your attendance. It is good to see the department head and elected officials here today. Thank you for your presence. And at this time, I'd like to call the meeting to order. And this is a follow-up session with Mr. Charles Weathers of the Weathers Group regarding our strategic vision priorities. And I would like to take just a moment to again welcome Justin Bradley. Justin, good to have you. And we'll have Bob Walker with us today, Bob. Good to have you on board. And I've already told Justin this first meeting, me and the way I wanted you to, the way I'm going to pass him a note and say advice, water just broke. You have a baby to any moment. So congratulations, Justin. I know you, thank you. Can't wait for that. And start a new chapter in your life as well. And the purpose of the next hour is to work on our top priorities and what outcomes we'd like to see and any wins related to our strategic planning efforts and to give staff guidance. And just to reiterate, on the bottom of the agenda, we have the vision. And this is starting with the group with Mr. Weathers. Spartanburg County's vision is to be a preferred destination for individuals, families, and businesses to live, learn, play, and invest. And the mission is Spartanburg County provides a foundation for superior quality of life for residents, unlimited opportunities for business, and an exceptional learning environment for education through purposeful planning, investment, and use of resources. So, that being said, Mr. Weathers, I'm going to turn the meeting over to you. Good to have you today with us again.
Thank you, Chairman Gordon. Good morning. Excuse me. Good afternoon, everyone. How are you?
Good afternoon.
It's truly an honor to be here with you today. Again, I appreciate you taking the time and opportunity to share and let me be part of this journey with you as we look at the implementation of your strategic plan. Before we get into that, I want to take a few moments to kind of just give you a broad overview of where we are and how we've gotten here. After the strategic planning session, and after we wrote the document and it was adopted by council, back in November, on November 20th, the department heads all convened at Cleveland Park for a half-day workshop, looking at that plan that council had adopted, looking at the vision and the mission and the value statements to make sure that we could have some ownership in that plan at the operational level. So one thing I want to do, particularly the department heads in the room today, is I want to thank them for their participation, because the fact of the matter is they didn't just show up, they were engaged. They really gave us input and feedback. They helped to frame this plan and document. And to give you a sense of the ownership that your department head is having this, every objective in your strategic plan now has a department head or leader of county who's in charge of that objective. So somebody stepped up and said, that's mine, I'll take it. That's mine, I'll take it. That's mine, I'll take it. So that was huge. And what that now does, we have this culture of accountability where leadership has stepped in and said, we're going to make sure this plan goes forward by taking it and making sure it's operationalized in their work plan so we can build traction and keep it going. And council, to your credit, I thank you for allowing us to come back and give you that update, because in many cases, people go about these strategic planning ventures and they sit around and they create a document that looks good and put it on the shelf and it sits there until 2 or 3 years later. Well, your plan is not just sitting there, you're moving it forward, and you've got a strong department head, and your management team is leading that effort as well. So I want to, in front of you, tell you they're doing a phenomenal job, and thank them for making my job easier. So I appreciate all the department heads and management team. That being said, what we want to do today as we go forward, we don't want to rehash the strategic plan. We have the plan, but now we want to talk about milestones. Now I want to talk about what does success look like as we continue to move in the same direction, as we use the vision and the mission as a framework for all decisions, all actions of the county. We want to talk about going forward, what does success look like, particularly in the next year or so. And what I wanted to ask council today was, give me an idea and let's talk about just what does success look like for you. What are some milestones or some significant accomplishments that we can say, this is a win. If we get this done in the next year, we can count that as a win. So I wanted to open it up to council, if I could, Chairman, to get some feedback on that. And again, we're not asking council how to do it. We're just asking what it is. And then Catherine and her management team, the department heads, they'll go back and work on the how. So if I can ask you now, does council have any feedback for us at this point in terms of what are some milestones or wins you want to see accomplished in the next year?
Ideas. I have a few things
jotted down,
but I'll save mine for last.
Let's just be able to improve per capita earnings
citizens of Spartanburg.
Charles, I'd like to see us be a little more proactive with our infrastructure.
Okay.
And being aggressive with that, making sure we're taking care of our citizens.
Proactive and aggressive with the infrastructure. Councilman, any more specificities to that? Can you pick out one thing and say if that were done, that would be an example of being proactive and aggressive with our infrastructure?
Well, I think what we're getting ready to talk about today in our Public Works Committee is the infrastructure fund that I'd like to have set up, which is to take some money off the top of our general fund budget and put it into infrastructure needs that we may have in the future when growth comes into an area of Spartanburg County, instead of us not being able to take care of those problems immediately, that we have a fund set aside so that when those problems do arise, that we could widen the road, or we could put in a traffic light maybe, or do some storm drain modifications that may need to be done, just so that we stay ahead of the growth and make sure that we're giving Spartanburg County a safe way to get through and navigate through the county, so that we're not holding up growth, we're protecting.
And do you also see that also aligning up with your objective as far as strengthening public-private partnerships by having that type of fund on the front end?
Absolutely. Right now, we have to kind of stand back and hope that somebody else steps up. And we need to be taking the lead on that. And that way, I think more people will be able to come on board and help us with that instead of always asking other people for help instead.
Fantastic. Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Any other wins? What would success or outcomes look like?
I think with the growth that we're seeing in Spartanburg County, one of the things that taps into exactly what Mr. Nutt is saying is our strategic area planning process that we're doing. I think that's going to help us identify. But I also feel like there's other special tax districts that we need to keep an open rapport with, such as our school districts and things, to know exactly what their growth plans are for the future and in the near future as well, so that we can also strategically work as far as getting our plans together to make sure the infrastructure is going to be there for any high growth or high traffic areas that we may see.
And currently right now, who's in charge, or who right now is kind of serving as the conduit between the different school districts and council, making sure we're all looking at the same plans, or those plans are converging in some place?
Well, I would say that our administrator is the one that gets information about that. Mm-hmm.
Can I expand on that?
Yes, sir.
In my discussions since being elected, school districts have come to me and said they want to be more involved. They want to be, have a say-so, or not necessarily say-so, but to make sure their concerns are voiced. And that leads us to not necessarily, when we talk about how we have education, doesn't necessarily mean to put more money. It means how we work together in this county. And one of our biggest problems going to be is this council has done an excellent job of growth, new industry. As Councilman Nutt pointed out, the infrastructure is a big problem. But at the same time, we're going to hit a block wall or a block wall if we are not prepared for our workforce employment. We have got to get on board with how we help those people that need to be trained, not necessarily the high school graduates or the college graduates, those people that have lost jobs. The workforce, we've got an excellent situation in this county with Spartanburg Community College, and we need to reach out more, in my opinion, than we're doing there. And not necessarily, again, it's funding, how we go about helping them with the programs that they've got to train these workers that we're going to need, because Councilman Horton and Rick can do everything they can get us new industry here, if we don't have the workforce to run those industries, they're gonna quit coming. All that needs to be in our planning and how we have workforce readiness. Thank you, sir.
That's very important.
Very important.
Anyone else?
Jim, were you a area performance planning, implementing that? I just want to make sure.
Charles, I think also would like to see Spartanburg County get on the cutting edge of technology internally. And I think we're still playing catch up right now. And I'd like to see us get where we're on the cutting edge as far as counties here in our area. And just as another, you know, that I'd like to see, I'd kind of go along with the other things we've been talking about, and people have been talking to me about this for years, is our gateways in Spartanburg County. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see that brought up to something we're all proud of.
We're working on some plans right now, so.
Yeah, we shared them with Roger a few minutes ago. We had a team, and basically those chairman encouraged us to do that a few months ago. We got that process rolling.
So I hear the IT infrastructure, because that serves as the backbone to support everything that we do, and then also the gateway.
That was one I had on the list, was getting our IT up to speed. I'll throw this out. I don't know that I'll get any support in this room on this, but we've been struggling the last few years, and I'd like to see a good pay incentive for the employees materialize as we move forward with the budget this year. And it's difficult times, but that, along with getting our fund balance up to about 15%, both of those would be high on my priority list to again get our employees at a little better level of pay, number one, to be competitive with other counties, and then B, to get our fund balance up. That's awfully important to me, because again, I've been through two major downturns, and every time it's brutal, and not our citizens suffer, our employees suffer when this occurs. So I will be ready for those tough times when they do come again. They will come again. So those would be two things that I see high.
I have to agree with that. Our employees have sacrificed and given up themselves way too long, and we need to be able to thank them in some monetary way.
Well, I think it's apparent, every time Catherine, each meeting, she has a recognition of the employees. We get a lot of great feedback, and just the other day, we had an article of somebody had written into the stroller about a few departments. So I think the employees recognize that the citizens recognize when they get good service when they come to the county. So I want to again thank the county employees for that, and appreciate them working through difficult times.
Kind of piggyback on that, Charles. And I agree with Jeff and Jay, that you do everything you can to increase that. And the reason is, so deficient in that area is this whole issue about local government. Millions and millions of dollars have been cut. Our employees have had to bear that burden. That's where salary increases have gone. We just kept essential services and kept people on board. We didn't lay off. But they've had to carry that. And Jeff and the other six council members sitting here, I think we're attacking that problem. I'd like to see, if we're wanting to write something down this year, is some type of resolution with the local government fund and having that money restored. And I think Spartanburg County is leading the charge through, again, our chairman and our administrator. And I think you're going to find other counties across the state jumping on board real soon.
Fantastic. Anything else? I'll kind of give you a recap of what I hear as far as the reviews of milestones that we call them that. Implementing the area performance planning, looking at some type of infrastructure funding, being on the cutting edge of technology and strengthening the IT infrastructure, looking at the gateway, interchanges and exchanges there, having some type of competitive pay incentive for employees, and getting the fund balance up.
You left off the first one, What
one was that?
Raising per
capita. I'm sorry, per cap earnings, thank you.
Which is economic development,
economic development.
And not just
Yeah. And workforce readiness, all I tie that with workforce readiness as well. Are we missing anything or anything else in addition to that?
We've talked about it. We need to, the people that I talk to, our number one problem, which makes us our, one of our number one goals, is goes back to what Roger mentioned, has to do with roads, bridges, and that. I mean, we're the number one issue out there on most of our constituents' mind is roads.
I didn't know you wanted to double the road fee your first meeting, Bob.
Don't put any words in my mouth.
He's way down there.
I was shocked.
When you called me that, I was.
I'm just kidding. He never said that.
They know what I said tonight.
What has to happen, what we see happening now, we talked about this is the what, now we go into the how. Again, you have more than a capable management team, administrative team, and department heads to go back and figure out the how. And part of that how also is recognizing that there's a sequence and process to getting this done now and working that out in a very prudent manner. At this point, Catherine, do you have any feedback on anything that's been said?
I think that the team that is in place would help with all of these wins. It would help me to have, I guess, some sort of for those things that you want to prioritize in the budget process, just to make sure that we're on the same page. But Councilman Nutt, I think later on today in your Public Works Committee, you're looking for some budgetary impact for this fund to try to help with public works improvements. And Chairman Horton, you're looking for a way to get a pay package into the budget process. On the IT side, I think it would be helpful if we can perhaps take what the CAT team worked on and maybe transition that to an IT committee who can look at really the backbone. It's the non-glamorous, non-fun side of IT, although I know that Kim and her team find that to be where all of the really good stuff happens. But at the end of the day, those aren't the things that we see on our desk or the programs that we roll out. It's the network that makes it all happen. It's the behind-the-scenes stuff. So I think that would be one of the things we may have to put into place rather quickly, so that as we're going through the budget process, that IT committee can help make some recommendations to us. Because that's our opportunity. The budget becomes our implementation guide for your strategic plan. It's where we put money to try to make these wins happen. The fund balance up to 15%, Chairman Horton, is that something that you want us to take a look at the end of each year, when we're seeing what funds have accumulated, not necessarily setting it up front, but at the end of the year, make some decisions about putting funds into the fund balance as opposed to putting it towards other uses. Okay. And you have my commitment to continue to move forward on the local government fund. That clearly changes things for us when we have to cover state expenses with local dollars.
Now, Charles, how does all this tie in with the meetings that we had last year? I mean, everything that we said today, does that still fall within our vision?
Everything you said today falls within the vision and mission framework that you had last year and falls under the goals and the objectives that are in place. So we are totally congruent and in line with that plan. And what's happening now is you actually are beginning a process now where strategic planning and budgeting now go hand in hand. And so now what we start doing, we develop the plan, we look at the budget implications of the plan, the budget's approved, the work is done, and then this is revisited, not just annually with council, but between then, we're meeting with department heads and others with the work plans to keep it consistent throughout the entire process. So we are not off track at all.
So what are you going to do, Catherine? We're going to list these and then let council number them, send them back to you, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever, and try to come up with top priority thing. What, how do you want to proceed?
Well, during the budget process.
And coupled with the department heads and other business
issues. Sure. So taking a look at what you talked about here, let's talk about the area planning process, and I'll touch on each other, but the area planning process is moving forward, Councilman Hall. So we're taking a look at the timelines for the public input process, and really seeing this as a 2015, a year-long project. So from a budgetary standpoint, Chairman Horton, there's really a lot of work being done by the planning staff. So I would imagine that at the point at which we start talking about ordinances and implementation and permitting and those types of things, that's when the real budget discussion will happen. But we'll still be working with Councilman Hall along the way to get the southwestern area plan in place in 2015. The technology to try to get us to cutting edge, I think it's going to be important, Councilman Nutt, for us to talk about what does cutting edge mean. When we take a look at those areas where we have delayed infrastructure, specific IT infrastructure investments, because we were taking that money to pay for something else. So we delayed an important purchase or delayed a project. I think it would be helpful for an IT committee to take a look at that before the budget process gets too far underway, so that as you're going through your budget work session, we can identify those things that we really think that ought to be prioritized by council as funds are available. So you have not only the budget process, but alluding to Chairman Horton's comments about the fund balance improvement, you'll have some funds, hopefully, if things all go right. We'll have some funds at the end of each fiscal year that we can put towards some of those initiatives, because we've collectively saved money throughout the year. Revenues have been stronger. Those types of things can help us with additional funds. When it comes to the infrastructure fund that Councilman Nutt talked about, I think you shared with me that you're just in about $200,000 to $250,000. We'll work as a team with the capital improvement plan to see how we can program in that amount so that it can be there when we have opportunities. You know, there was a particular public-private partnership that came up actually through economic development. It was in terms of size, it was a good commercial project in an area that was depressed, and it needed some help with adjoining stormwater problems where the outfall was going to go. I think this fund would go a long way towards that. Really thinking back, that was one of the last meetings I was in with Steve Ballou, where he was looking for a way to cobble together money for a project that we all knew would be great for that community. I think I hear what you're saying, Councilman Nutt, is let's not be sitting there when we have a great opportunity and trying to figure out where we're going to, which project are we going to rob to try to get these funds together, because this opportunity has presented itself. If we have what would be relatively small amount of money at first, that kind of carries over each year with anything that we haven't spent, then those opportunities are less of a difficulty. We were just really fortunate that Steve Ballou was able to pull together a pretty good plan.
In that particular case, not only did that help that development come in, but it solved a similar problem for several houses along a corridor that had been having problems for decades.
Yes.
So,
and I'm glad you mentioned that, Captain. That's exactly right. I mean, it was just, you know, just an example of the type of person Steve was, thinking outside the box, how to make this project happen. He did. We ought to name this fund that passes today, the Steve Ballou Fund, actually, because that's exactly what he did.
He's
done
a lot of
time. I ride by that place every day, and it helped all those folks out there. So we ought to consider that.
We wouldn't come totally agree with that. That's great.
Yeah.
So now you're talking about the budget process. I mean, those would be things that, as I understand those, to be priorities or wins. I think it's like outcomes.
Outcomes, yes.
That we can, Jim and I will work with Cole and Kelly and the department heads to make sure that that's in there. When you see the recommended budget, that those initiatives are there. The gateway improvement, I know Councilman Britt, you and I have been working with a number of partners. They're looking at mostly the private side helping us with this, sort of like the spot of pride. And that's wonderful. You know, the impact to your budget will be minimal, but the impact to the community is going to be. So I guess I'm offering that to you, that as we get started, a lot of these that you're offering to us are wins that won't necessarily the pay package is obviously very significant. We should put that as I understood council coming out of your retreat, that would be a top priority, that you would want to see us to recover our pay and compensation goals, and to see that happen very quickly. So as Jim and I have been approaching the budget, that's, and have talked to the department heads, that's where my top priority has been in anticipation of this meeting, is to make sure that happens first in the budget. And then it looks like we'll be working on an infrastructure fund in the CIP and IT projects as well. This is where I'm hearing you go, as far as budget is concerned. As we get farther along with the strategic plan, it's not going to be that easy to identify those in 15, 20 minutes. Those are things that, if you think about those three things, they're things we have deferred because of our economic condition. So we have delayed pay adjustments, we've delayed IT, and we've delayed infrastructure. So we're focusing on those areas that we know, you know as council, I know as your administrator, we need to focus on those. Once we get them headed in the right direction, those wins and outcomes are going to take a lot more discussion for you, because you'll have to prioritize the new things we're going to try to tackle. What I'd like to do, Chairman Horton, is to take these that you talked about today and work with Charles to make sure that you know which goal and which objective you'll be furthering by each one of these. Because if you said that that's your goal and those are your objectives, then everything we do should fall under those, so that you accomplish your mission and vision. So I think that would be our next challenge, just to make sure that we do that. And if there's any that we find that we can't get into one of your goals, I think we're going to be okay with these. But if we didn't, we need to bring that back and say it doesn't fit into your plan. So you either have to change the plan or change the key outcome. Okay.
That's exactly right. And at this point, now we go into prioritization, as Kathy was mentioning. Now we go back and we figure out the how, and then present that back to council.
Workforce readiness and the economic development, Councilman Grimm, that'd be the only one I really haven't touched on. And I think that that's just going to need to remain a high priority every year. That we're going to need to work as hard as we can to make sure that there isn't anything getting in the way of workforce readiness, there isn't anything getting in the way of economic prosperity in the county, so that we're working as a team, that the partnerships that we talk about, that they're strengthened, so that we can outpace our competition, if you will, in making sure we're bringing economic prosperity to this county. Hope that helps.
It does. I mean, and again, all seven things that we talked about here does keep our vision and our mission straight ahead on raising per capita income. You know, it's kind of a general thing, but it does help us be specific. Like, you know, as we work with the cities, municipalities in the county, why it's so important to be working with PACA, the city of Spartanburg. You know, the articles in yesterday's paper, why does that hotel issue, how does it affect us? A lot. Again, recruiting white collar, top-notch companies here that does raise that economic, you know, level. All our, you know, our performance area planning, that's what the top companies are asking for. Our, you know, parks and rec, everything, all the things that we're working on, roads and bridges, all of that. I mean, it impacts that one thing that I, you know, pretty passionate about. And like I say, anything that gets in the way of, you know, workforce readiness, we need to, you know, get it out of the way.
So, Chairman Horton, one of the things that will be also important as we go forward with our scheduling is that a strategic visioning retreat or a council retreat each year sometime in the August, September, we've taken, Charles and I had a chance to take a look at sort of how our calendar falls for budgeting. If you were to meet as a group, as a team, around the end of August, early September, and checked in on the plan, maybe a day session where you get some presentations on where we are with your goals and objectives, sort of a check-in on that, and then talk about anything that you want to modify, change, adjust, and then have the same conversation about key wins or outcomes that you're looking for. That'll help me with the department heads to make sure that we're gearing up the CIP and the budget each year for that. If that just becomes sort of an annual process, then I think this will fit in nicely to where you'll see what you're asking for presented as part of a recommended budget from CIP or the general.
Well, Catherine, how do you want to proceed as far as the local government fund? Are we going to proceed based on projected revenues or revenues from the local government fund? I think we had word on the governor's plan for the local government fund. How would that affect us so far?
Sure. So I think what I've been asked to do by council is to prepare a budget that identifies those state mandates that are covered under the local government fund so that you can better position yourself going through your budgeting process at the same time the General Assembly is making some of these decisions, so that you can ultimately determine how you want to approach the state's needs. And do I understand that you'd like a clear answer at this point, but there's a lot of discussion that needs to occur at the State House about the mandates that are placed on local governments and whether they want to take back some of those mandates that I've heard you as a group talk about. It doesn't really matter to me. These are state expenses. Either the state needs to pay for them or take the mandates back, eliminate the mandates, take the services back, or send enough money to cover them. It doesn't really matter to you what combination of that happens. As long as our citizens are not having to pay, I think I've heard several of you comment that they're almost paying twice for these services. So I would like to see a healthy discussion of that this year in the General Assembly, and I think they're positioned to have that discussion. Hopefully, the local government fund will be reinstated by the time that you're considering the third reading of the budget.
Well, you know, one of the proposals was to phase it in over a 3-year period of time, so if I'm going to the numbers on that as well, bring it back up to speed over a 3-year period of time.
Just means that you're still heavily subsidizing those expenses over a 3-year period. We've been heavily subsidizing them for a number of years now.
Do.
Yes, sir.
Do you propose that we have a brainstorming time? I mean, I've seen two bills, I think, have been filed in the House. And one of them basically does what you said. The other one basically, it seems to be, if I read it correctly, the leadership, to go back and do away with the 4.5% and go to a lower percentage. And make it based on what the projections are each year after there. And that basically sounds to me like that you're going to see less and less money.
Basically, it says they're sticking their finger in our eye.
As House 3374, if anybody's interested in, and that's something that we definitely do not want to see pass.
Well, my take on all the different bills is we've already got a law, and if we were having this discussion while they were giving us the 4.5%, then let's have the discussion. But in the meantime, they're doing whatever they want to, so it didn't really make me feel any better. They're getting ready to pass some kind of bill, because when they pass bills, they don't follow them anyway. So I think, you know, our stance currently is, and always has been, as far as I know, that we want the 4.5%. And if you want to do something else, but right now give us the 4.5% and tell us what it's going to be in the future, and let's deal with it.
Chairman Horton, you have my commitment that the budget will be presented in such a way to where you could clearly identify these, because they're really across your general fund budget. Some of them, stormwater fee, you've already passed on as an additional cost to our citizens, libraries, those types of things that some other counties are counting on the local government fund. It seems to me that this council, although I wasn't here at the time, felt like there was handwriting on the wall that we were going to have some problems with this. So in order, I think, for you to make the best decision that you can with local government fund is to make sure the budget's presented in such a way to where you can clearly identify how much funding would come from whatever bills and energies. We're barely a week and a half into the general session for the General Assembly. So let's see how the bills come and we can determine where we want to place our support. I heard that there was a bill filed saying pay 4.5% towards local government fund, which is what our local delegation voted unanimously to do. So I suppose if more counties and delegations got together like we did with ours and explained the situation and had them unanimously support full funding of local government fund, we probably wouldn't be having this discussion. So I certainly want to be sure that I'm clear that nothing that I say about local government fund reflects on our local delegation. They have been lockstep with this council on fully supporting full funding, which is how all the counties.
Well, that's one thing I want everyone to know. It's not because they haven't heard from us, and it hasn't been because they haven't heard from that lady right there. She has spoken with the delegation members. They're well aware. In our delegation, we're not bashing our delegation. On board, we've got to get more on board. But Catherine has definitely been giving our story. Thank you.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I think it's Bob Well knows, after serving 16 years down there, that train's going to leave the station, even though they're only a week and a half into the session. That train's already pulling out right now. I mean, the tracks are being laid. Like you say, the leadership, Chairman Wazen, he's made it known where he wants this thing to go. And I don't think we're going to have the benefit of waiting too long. If we're going to do anything, I shared this in our last, one of our last meetings. The question has been asked a couple of times, why aren't we the only ones, making a big deal out of this? The other counties aren't. Why does Spartanburg County have such a rough time with it? So we probably ought to get our act together pretty quickly. We're going to organize some other counties to work with us. And like I said, we got a 16-year veteran right there. Let Bob help us with that, but what we ought to do, I'm just thinking as you were talking, Catherine, we're talking about salary increases for our employees being one of our top seven things. We have to tie that right in with the local government fund, put the number out there and show the legislature this is what we're talking about. We're not talking about capturing this money to go build new buildings. We're putting this money in our employees where you took it out of. Let's as you work up your numbers, let's make sure we can show that. That'd be a great way to do it.
The key thing, and you're correct, and number one, Roger, is we should insist no proviso. As long as they stick that proviso in, then they do what they want it. So our step right now should be no proviso, but yet then that forces them to go back to the statute unless they do line item changes there. But you're correct, and what you're saying is we need for the people in Spartanburg County. No disrespect to our delegation. They're doing what we've asked them to do. Is the people in Spartanburg County need to understand every dollar that we take and put it into the unfunded mandates that are not being met in the government fund is taking away your tax dollars to go for county services, whether it's to increase the salaries or to pay for roads or to do whatever it is that the $3 or $4 million that we don't get each year, it cuts us what we can do in our service for Spartanburg County. That's the key that the people in Spartanburg County need to understand. It is taking your tax dollars that you're paying to Spartanburg County for state aid assistance.
Well, I haven't shared this with anyone, maybe the council members, but about 12 years ago, I was fortunate enough to have a meeting with the Ways and Means Committee, and I was there trying to secure funds for Highway 99 and a few other things to get it widened. And Speaker Wilkins was still the speaker, so that's how long ago it was. And I was up there begging for all this money. And that evening, there's a dinner meeting. He looked at me and said, "Horton," he said, "Do you have a road fee to help fund roads in your county?" I said, "No, sir." He said, "Do you have a hospitality tax to help you with park projects and those type of things?" I said, "No, sir." He said, "Do you have a 1 cent sales tax for whatever?" I said, "No, sir." He said, "Get those things in place to come back down here and see me, son. Okay, so you can see through the years, we've moved towards that, to use all the tools that we had at our disposal. One thing we probably, I don't know if you call it negligent, but we haven't done in this county, is we have not taken advantage of the cost of living increases that, you know, were lately to us. And so that's probably one thing that has hurt us as well, and maybe some of the other counties have been doing that. I haven't done the research on those numbers, and I know Roger had a meeting a couple of weeks ago, and he was involved with a neighbor county. I won't mention the name unless he does. But again, we haven't done that. We've been pretty frugal with people's tax dollars here, maybe at our own expense. But I think this year is the year that we really have to address this, and we don't have to make some tough decisions, finally. And I feel like we've been making tough decisions the past few years, and but again, we've got to continue. Go ahead, what else?
Sure, we tried to work with Charles on the outcomes and the key things that we wanted, the key wins. This is a relatively new process for us as a group. Council being the team, and the team providing you the advice on how to accomplish your goals. I think if we start here, without it being too complicated, I think we need to learn this tool and this process together. All of you have been involved in strategic planning, and I would argue that the council members who have been here over the years, Chairman Horton, you, Councilman Britt, you did strategic planning, and the fruits of your effort are showing in announcements like BMW, Toray, Cabalco, all of these companies. And it is impossible to imagine that this county wouldn't be doing strategic planning without putting it in a document and accomplishing those things. So you've done a wonderful job with planning strategically. Now we have a framework for it. We're going to test drive it and do a few of these items, these seven items that we talked about, and see how it works. And if we accomplish what council sees as a key outcome or key win, and if we do, then we keep doing that again and again, because it's the key to our success. Is that fair?
The process right now, like you say, the test drive at this point, and to stick with that kind of analogy, we want to be able to create some type of balanced scorecard or dashboard for council. So when we come before you, you don't have to go through page by page. 4, 5, 6, 7, whatever the indicators are, those key performance indicators, what they look like. So we're reporting them back to you. You can see the progress taking place, and you can adjust in real time if necessary to change direction or make sure we stay on course. So it's a process of accountability, and Catherine, to your point, with us working with you throughout this next year or so, we're working with department heads, management team, and council to ensure everybody's on the same page.
And Councilman Hall, I know that one of the goals that council had was capitalize on natural resources and tourism opportunities. And I just wanted to show you as a chairman of livability, we're going to be working on this. Just because it isn't listed necessarily as an IT project or an infrastructure project or a pay package, I know that Jim Campbell and Chris Jennings and Laura Ringo and all of our partners that are working with us on tourism and natural resources, we're going to continue to have wins there. This afternoon, I'm going to be announcing yet another win that we've had. That particular goal is working with the strength of the partners that we have that I've listed. So we'll just keep doing what we have been doing there because we know it's working. And we'll focus on these other areas that you guys have listed today and bring back a win. And as we go through the budget, Chairman Horton, and as we go through the council agenda, I'll try to note these as they're coming up on your agenda, that this is one more step towards accomplishing a win that you have identified today so that you can see the progress happening. Because we do get caught up in everything else that's going on. It's hard to, sometimes it's hard to see more action-making progress in some of these things.
Well, from what I've gathered from our council members, we're serious about the local government.
I understand. So am I.
Dead serious. If that helps you proceed.
Yes,
sir. Well, there's anything I can
make. No, sir.
I appreciate you coming.
Thank you.
Appreciate you. Working with us. Hopefully, your feedback
Mr. Chairman, I want to take this moment to thank Charles. He has been a wonderful partner in working with us and trying to motivate us and to keep our vision clear as we try to help you. I told him before I started, I always love the day after Charles is here because everybody's always pumped up. We can always see the positive, and the second day is really where you start to see everyone enjoying the fruits of the labor. So Charles, I want to thank you for the time that you spent with our team, and I look forward to many more opportunities.
You're welcome. Appreciate it.
Thank you for helping us to be successful.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, sir. Well,
hi. Who's Charles?
Yes, sir.
Hi. The strategic plan.
Yes, sir.
And this was discussed before I was in office. Yeah. We talked about the southwest area and putting effort there. But what we talked about here today, a lot of that's totally countywide and all that. Are we looking in the near future? Is this something that is more than a year away? What we were talking about, our main emphasis, because I got people in my district, which is rural, won't know, what are we doing? I said, well, it's my understanding that the first area is going to be the southwest, and we're looking at how that we plan or how we look at handling the many problems. That's not to say we don't handle stuff in the other part of the county, but are we head full force while we're talking about all this other or the southwest area?
So the strategic planning process that we've been talking about, the strategic plan, has a lot of different components. One of the objectives under goal number one was to establish and implement a land use planning process and policy framework, and that would be on page 7 of that document.
Right.
So when we talk about the area performance planning, what we're talking about is trying to accomplish objective 1.2. And in trying to cover 850 square miles, it's over 800 square miles, no matter how you slice it. In trying to cover that amount of property in the county and be appropriate in the way that we're soliciting public input, we've been working on the Southwestern corridor. It is largely where the growth is occurring. Councilman Nutt's area is predominantly comprised in the southwest area. I think there's a small portion of District 5 that touches that area around. So a lot of the work that's going to be done in the southwestern corridor is going to set the stage for a future area. And we have identified 5 areas, something magic about 5. It just, the areas as they developed in the geographic areas of the county, it just seemed like those areas all went together and had the same growth pressures or the same type of land uses that were going under the same objectives to try to help the land users. So the short answer to your question is I'd really like to see us get through the Southwest Corridor first and then have the Planning Commission provide some feedback to you about, now that we have that taken care of and it's in place, what would be the next area or areas that you would want to try to tackle? Because it isn't about sitting in an office. I'm not suggesting that you're saying this, Councilor Watson, but it's not about sitting in office and generating an ordinance. It's about getting out in the field and looking at the land uses, what's compatible, what's not, the road infrastructure, to Councilman Nutt's point, what can we handle with the growth? Are we trying to concentrate the growth where the infrastructure is, such as our 5-lane highways, where our sewer is, where our water is, those where all our utilities are? Are we trying to get that type of growth there? How are we handling the housing? So the Southwest Corridor is going to take more time to work through those questions on what policies and procedures council wants in place to try to help with that land use and growth. And then once we get that down, and I don't want to oversimplify this for Bob Parker here, if he's in the audience, the next several plans will be a lot, several areas will be a lot easier.
And this has been, the whole plan was so that we would divide the county up in sections and address each individual section as it needed to be addressed.
Right. So in case Bob is in the audience, I don't want him to pass
out. He's
out there.
He's probably reached a little shallow. We're not anticipating having all 5 areas in 2015.
My concern, and I think this is where goes to Roger. Whenever we talked this is good, but part of the plan was to make sure that we have the arteries, the roads, and all that. So maybe I'm getting broad enough, but I'm concerned that we have got to have, if we were going to say this road, this artery is going to be best served for this, we got to have those arteries up to the standards that we need to do that. And that's what's concerning me, is even though 290, yes, it's probably pretty well planned, but we got other areas that's in that area and adjoining that we see in humongous development, but we know the roads are nowhere near going to handle that development. That's the part that concerns me, and I think what Roger's saying is we need to look at that, but we got to make sure we get those arteries first.
Sure. And Councilman Walker, I'm sure that the plan that Councilman Nutt's putting forward of $250,000 is not going to address some of the state needs. And then the best thing that can happen for Spartanburg County is for the state to get their house in order when it comes to roads, because they need to be a partner at the table talking with us about growth in Spartanburg County. If Councilman Britt and Chairman Horton and the rest of you are being successful when it comes to recruiting economic prosperity in the industries to this county, then we are an engine for South Carolina. I think we should be receiving a lot of attention when it comes to our road infrastructure if our location is going to be a successful one for South Carolina. We're one of the star players on the team, if you will.
And not just Charleston.
But to your point, a lot of the roads you just talked about, the arterials, those, I can assure you, they're not in the county system. So the state needs to get their road house in order so that they can be a viable partner with us in trying to plan, because the growth is coming. You've seen the reports, you've seen the discussions. The population growth in the upstate is going to increase. It's going to increase at an increased rate because of our proximity to Interstate 85 and the corridor from Raleigh to Atlanta. So the question really becomes, if the growth is coming, what are we going to do about it? Are we going to plan for it or just let it happen? And if we just let it happen, we have to be satisfied with how it happens. And I've heard all of you say, I'd rather know that it's going to be successful when we get to the other side, that you want your legacy to be that you did the things you need to do, you put the things in place that need to be in place in order for that growth to be good. And leave this county better than you found it.
You know, this is exactly what we wanted to have happen. Yes. You know, we identified that the Southwest, we wanted areas to step up and say, we need help. So this is perfect. I think this is great, and I agree with Bob. Maybe, and with all that's going on up in your area, you have to light a fire and get James here to get done a little quickly and move quickly to your area.
Yeah. And Councilman Walker, that I testified to the ad hoc committee dealing with transportation issues right now, so they've heard our feelings about council's feelings about transportation needs and infrastructure in Spartanburg County.
All right, Charles, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate you being here with us. All right, this will conclude this particular session of our work session today. And we do have scheduled next an executive session. We have three items, contractual matters today, legal advice on a couple other matters. So at this moment, I think we best go into executive session. We'll go to the conference room after the motion is made. Is that cool with you, Lisa?
That's fine.
Good to do it here. Okay. We have a motion to go into executive session.
Well, before that, remember you need a motion.
You do?
Yeah, we were going.
I thought you were going to do the same thing.
Yeah.
All right. Before we go into executive session, I need a motion for Carter Smith to come into executive session to provide information regarding the contractual matters.
So moved.
Have a motion. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? All right, now I need a motion to go into executive session. Motion, second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? On affirmative, and it passes. Thank you. We are scheduled to return at 4 o'clock.